to the 12 o'clock on the dot. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the National Black Church Initiative, next episode of the Clinical Trials Lecture Series. Thankful to have two experts, scientific experts, that are going to lead us in conversation around clinical trials and their role in colorectal cancer space. But I will pass the mic to Reverend Evans, who will get us started with today's event.
Okay, very good. Thank you. This is the third in the series of our National Clinical Lecture Series, and we certainly honor our two guests who are here to deal with the issue around colon cancer in the African-American community, which is a huge problem and a huge issue. We have tackled this issue before, if those of you who have viewed our website, and we continue to tackle this issue across the country. So we're looking forward to a reinvigorating this movement and to make sure that all of our 150,000 churches are engaged into prevention, education, outreach, and of course, pre-screening, and if necessary, clinical trials and treatment. And certainly we want to welcome our two guests, and Ramona, we'll introduce them in a minute. Right now we'll get started with Minister Greg Allen out of Israel Baptist Church, who's an associate minister there, and serve as NBCI Maryland Faith Command leader. Greg.
Blessings and greetings to everyone. Let us bow our heads as we go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father and our God, creator of the universe and creator of mankind, I thank you for this day and for this truly is a day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I thank you because in the midst of tragedy and suffering, you bring us hope. I thank you in the unity that that you have brought about today as we come together from different backgrounds, different cultures, different economic levels, different belief systems to fight for a common cause and reach a common goal. I thank you that in the moment that you are helping us to realize that we are all God's children, united we stand and divided we will surely fall. As we come and look for your guidance and your healing power, I pray that you will bring healing to our land, healing from the disparities of healthcare and economic disparities, educational disparities, and disparities that keep us from being all that you have created us to be. Lord, we know that you are balm in Gilead. I pray now that you would be with the doctors and the scientists as they work together to eradicate healthcare disparities. Bless them with the wisdom and the knowledge necessary to help heal the land. Allow your people to realize the necessity for the clinical trials and the need for their participation. Give them the vision to see that the clinical trials will ensure that new treatments and therapies that are safe and effective will be developed and equitability distributed to all in need. God, we also look to you for comfort to the families who have already lost loved ones and the prevalent disease in the community, and to heal those who still suffer from the efforts or the effects of these diseases. Lord, we pray that you will bring us together, that you will heal our land, help us to remain in spirit of unity so that you will, or your will be done in the earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Very good.
So again, thank you everyone for being with us this afternoon. So I am Ramona Burress. I'm a clinical pharmacist by training, but also a cancer patient. But I work during the day as Associate Director of Diversity and Inclusion at Janssen Pharmaceuticals. So again, having a conversation this afternoon around colorectal cancer, because March is Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month, but also to pay tribute to Chadwick Boseman, actor who we know succumbed, unfortunately, to colorectal cancer in 2020. So his passing really brought colorectal cancer to the forefront for many folks, definitely felt the impact in our African-American community. And unfortunately, many of us didn't know Chadwick directly, but if we pause for a moment and think about those who are within our circles, within our families, within our friend circles that may have been directly impacted by colorectal cancer, I'm sure that we could name a few. For me, that person is Mrs. Tibra Ferguson in Chicago, here where I live. So with that, I mean, we know that the disparities are real in the cancer space. The American Cancer Society released some statistics maybe in the fall of 2020, and they stated that colorectal cancer is the second leading cause of death of all cancers. And when you drill that down to the African-American community, African-Americans are 20% more likely to be diagnosed with colorectal cancer, and unfortunately, 40% more likely to die from colorectal cancer when you compare our rates of incidence to other groups. So with that, I'm happy to have two scientific experts who work with me at Janssen Pharmaceuticals who are gonna walk us through why being present and being represented in clinical trials is important to get rid of those disparities that I just mentioned, and not only in colon cancer, but to other cancers as well too. So I'm so excited to be joined today by Dr. Jaszianne Tolbert. Jaszianne is a director of clinical development and oncology at Janssen. She is a board certified pediatrician, a pediatric hematologist, oncologist, formally trained in pediatric clinical pharmacology. She has worked as a physician in academia and director of pediatric early phase clinical trial program before she joined Janssen in 2019. While at Janssen, she has worked in the solid tumor oncology space. And okay, I'm a pharmacist. I'm still going to butcher these names. So Dr. Tolbert, help me out. Erdafitinib, did I get it right? Which is a tumor agnostic and bladder cancer clinical trials. And she currently works in a hematology clinical trial space for cusatuzumab for treatment for acute myeloid leukemia. And then also for talquetamab clinical trials for relapse and refractory multiple myeloma. And Dr. Tolbert is also going to be joined by Dr. Justin Callaway, who is the Associate Director of Biomarkers and Diagnostics in the Colorectal Cancer Interception Team here at Janssen. Justin earned his PhD in Microbiology and Immunology from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, where he studied the innate immune response to the dengue virus infection. From there, Justin joined GlaxoSmithKline in 2015 to focus on immune biology of the skin, investigating biomarkers and novel targets for skin disease of interest. In 2018, Justin moved into his true passion by joining the oncology group at GlaxoSmithKline, where he served for 2 years as a clinical biomarker lead on oncology clinical trials, primarily focused on pancreatic cancer. As a biomarker lead, Justin sought to understand the biological effects of treatments in patients, as well as identifying the right patients for therapies he supported. In 2020, Justin joined the Colorectal Cancer Interception Group at Janssen and our oncology research and development team. In this role, Justin works to understand who is at highest risk of developing colorectal cancer in the future, which would enable us to eradicate this devastating disease by enabling us to create therapeutic interventions before cancer even develops. So with that, thank you both again for being part of this conversation. And Reverend Evans, did you want to get started with the questions?
Sure. I want to yield to our a member of our task force of the National Clinical Strategy Task Force at NBCI, Dr. Joseph Webster. He is also currently chairing our NBCI COVID-19 Data and Information Committee. So Dr. Webster, welcome. Please, and please turn on your mic so that we can hear you. And certainly we will honor you if you can, I'm going to kick it off if you can follow me with a question, okay?
Right, go ahead.
Okay, very good. One of the things that is very apparent in the African-American community is the lack of real, clear, and targeted education to African-American, especially African-American men and women, about colon rectal cancer. Because we are bombarded with so many other health concerns, that gets sort of pushed down in our community. Can you explain why that is so, Dr. Tolbert, and what we can do in the African-American community utilizing these large group of churches that we have?
Dr. Webster. You said Dr. Tolbert.
No, okay, Dr. Tolbert.
Okay. First of all, good noonday, and thanks to Reverend Evans and his vision for and teaming up with Corporate America and Bio to host these kinds of sessions to shed some light on colorectal cancer and other cancers that are certainly more important, more devastating in our communities. To the panelists, thank you for your participation. I'm eagerly looking forward to your lectures. I do have a pharmacy background. I was a pharmacist in undergraduate school at one point, so I'm truly interested in the pharmacological aspects of what's going on and the new horizons that you'll be talking about. Colorectal cancer in the Black community, as all cancers are, unfortunately, are not adequately talked to our communities in the proper language that we can understand them. When it comes to colorectal cancer, particularly for the Black male, there's been a lot of stigma, a lot of myths about whether men can get the cancer, and also there's concerns about even getting the examination to look for cancer, both urological cancer and rectal cancer. So there are a lot of barriers in our communities from the part of our community itself. On the other hand, the lack of access to adequate health care, the lack of access to practitioners who look like us, that we have more trust in. So those disparities play out in educating people by someone that they trust, someone that looked like them. And then when the history of what has happened to us in clinical trials and the general distrust of medicine overall overarches our intent to try to educate the community properly, that we might come to the test so we can be detected and properly treated for colorectal cancer. Unfortunately, again, the comorbid social determinants that shape our lifestyles also lead us into directions where we eat more kinds of foodstuffs that predispose to colorectal cancer. So it's a whole gamut of things that we need to address holistically that is not done in the Black community. So what we're going to talk about today, looking at the genetic aspects of it and said digging deep in that aspect, tying that into the social aspect with the church's role, the spiritual role, and how to get our people more likely to take the test is going to be very important. So I'm very eager to hear what's going to take place, and thank you for the opportunity to say something.
Dr. Tolbert?
Actually, my first question is for Justin, Dr. Callaway. I wanted to talk about some of the work that your team is doing in the colorectal cancer space, if we can.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can jump straight into that. There's been such wonderful introduction on colorectal cancer in general. And actually, thank you all for the opportunity to even speak on this, because we're really excited about what we're working on, because it's obviously a devastating disease. Many of those points have already been highlighted. Chadwick Boseman as well is, you know, an iconic figure there to show that not only is there racial disparities there too, but also there's the young onset. He passed away at a very, very young age. So the incidence is increasing in that young population as well. You know, it is a very common disease. And if you have a first degree relative that has it, you're even higher risk. Even if you have first degree relative with the precancerous adenomas, you know, a lot, as Dr. Webster hit, there are modifiable risk factors like diet, lifestyle, you know, how much exercise, smoking, alcohol. So there's the opportunity to intervene, but there's disparities even beyond that. And so the good news is it is a preventable disease. With the colonoscopies can really reduce CRC incidence and mortality, because it's a disease you can catch early. So an early detection is key here. So, but one important point is not everybody is up to date on screening. So you see only 66% of adults age 50 and older report having a CRC screening within the past 3 to 10 years, whether it be a colonoscopy or one of the non-invasive tests. So now it recognized earlier and earlier that the age of 45 should be when an average risk person should start to get screened for CRC. But if you're higher risk, like my wife, actually, you know, Ramona, you mentioned somebody close to you that has a story here with CRC. Well, my father-in-law had stage 3 colorectal cancer. Thankfully, he survived. But my wife is high risk now. She started colonoscopy screenings in her 30s. So, you know, it's just, if you're average risk, you should begin at 45. But if you're high risk, you should begin even earlier than that. So,
importance of knowing that family history.
Absolutely. Yeah, it is very important. So, you know, we've highlighted a lot of the inequities. You know, Ramona, you did a great job in that introduction there. We'll say, of course, a lot of it can be tied to disparities in screening. but not all of it. And I think that the big key is, what are the biological differences? And that's what we're trying to get to as well. And if I can point to that one box, we see that African-Americans are 4 times more likely to be diagnosed with right-sided CRC, which is more aggressive than left-sided CRC. So, you know, that you can't tie that to just screening, right? There's something different underlying there. And so that's the sorts of questions we're trying to get at, because we can't change, you know, our group, there's obviously so many disparities from screening all the way to the very end, but what we're really focusing on, what can we make an impact in our group? And it's the precision medicine strategies, making sure they're equitable, right? And the paradigm in medicine can't change except through clinical trials. So we really think that increased diversity in the clinical trials is really key to eliminating the racial disparities, because so many of the genetic risk factors that we know and precision medicine strategies for other drugs and just drugs in general, they're so tied to clinical trials that are really biased towards the European descent white population, right? So we can even point to examples where we know that in the African American population, there are known mutations, but there's not enough data behind them to say, does this mutation cause the risk of cancer? Because it's just not enough known. So you get what's known as a variant of uncertain significance, which basically means it's a mutation and we don't know if it's important, right? So, you know, just using that as an example, how can we, in our strategy to prevent colorectal cancer, you know, make sure what we're doing is equitable? And so to highlight some of what we're doing, right, as a colorectal cancer interception group, we're really excited to change the paradigm where it's no longer just diagnosis of late stage colorectal cancer, which can be difficult to treat. We're looking to predict the risk of colorectal cancer in the future, because if we can shift that paradigm up, we can go from, you know, late detection and struggle to treat, whereas early detection is easier to treat. But if we can predict risk of the future disease, then we can talk about eradication of the disease. And that's what gets really excited. We want to make sure we do that equitably as well, not just, you know,
You are talking genetic testing, right?
There could be a genetic component to it as well, but there could also be, you know, environmental pressures that are different as well. So really the molecular changes, absolutely, there could be a genetic component, but there could be other pressures as well. And we want to make sure we can identify those in a safe and convenient way, and then identify how to treat those. And we want to make sure that, you know, the biomarkers, which are kind of the signals we look at inside the body, apply to all populations.
Yeah, Justin, I love the work that your team is doing, because this is kind of showing where we need that diversity, even in a preclinical drug development stage, right? So we don't even have a drug that treats colorectal cancer. You know, Dr. Tolbert, there's nothing in solid tumor right now, but there's so much work that we need to catch up on and learn about those who are disproportionately impacted before we can even get to the point where we develop drugs. And Dr. Tolbert, I guess that's where I want to take the conversation next with you. Like, why is it important? Again, why is representation important? Why should we be a part of this process?
Yeah, so we're in this era, what we call, like Justin alluded to, personalized and precision medicine. So we've become so smart now that we don't have to treat cancers the way we used to, where we had the whole, like, we'll throw this big bomb of chemotherapy at it and we'll kill all the cells, hoping that we get the cancer cells as well. So we don't have to do that anymore. We don't have to subject patients to all those awful side effects that you get from those chemotherapies that do just that. We can hone in and target the things that make a person unique and the things that make their cancer unique now with these drugs. And it's amazing, right? It's been really transformative for cancers and how we treat cancers, but we're still leaving people like myself behind and out of the equation. And we can't continue to do that. If we're going to be in an era of personalized and precision medicine, it still has to be equitable. We still have to personalize it to other people that don't necessarily look like the majority of the racial groups. And that's important for a whole lot of reasons, right? Because we know that when we look at genetics and we look at cancer genetics, not just the genetics of the person, that among different racial groups, it looks different. So my cancer and your cancer may have the same name, but the way we treat them may need to be very different. We may need to take a completely different approach. And the only way we can figure that out is if we include people that are of different racial backgrounds and ethnic backgrounds, so we discern out those differences and figure out who needs what, you know, what's the most optimal treatment for this particular person. We know that in order to do that, we have to have diversity in clinical trials, because where do we get access to the most up and coming medicines? It's not just going to your doctor and say, hey, I want this new medicine that they just came out with. It's in a clinical trial. That's how we provide the first access. That's where we take the first look and figure out what's the next steps to take with this drug. And if we're conducting clinical trials in a disease area where most of the people who get it are tall Black women, but all of the people in the clinical trial are short white men, then how are we actually going to answer that question and take what we learned from the clinical trial and say, okay, yeah, we tested it in short white men, but this should be used for the tall Black women. We can't do that. We have to have a diverse clinical trial population that looks like the population that actually gets the disease. And even the FDA has honed in on this as well. You know, the FDA has guidances now as to industry persons like myself that tells us that you really should make sure that your clinical trials represent the population that you're serving. And then just at Johnson & Johnson or J&J, we have this credo that tells us that our first obligation is to the patients and the healthcare providers. And if we're not ensuring that these trials are diverse and representative of everyone, then we're not fulfilling that credo or that ethical obligation that we have.
Thank you, Dr. Tolbert, for that. Because, you know, we started the conversation about colorectal cancer because it is Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month. But again, I think no matter what type of cancer that we're looking at, we see that same disproportionate mortality rates with African-American communities. I know myself for breast cancer, that's been an issue. So can we talk about how the same theme continues to go into other cancer spaces as well?
Yeah. And as you mentioned, I work in the hematology diseases. So I work with a lot of blood cancers. And Dr. Callaway alluded to colorectal cancer. You know, this is applied all. That's a solid tumor. Multiple myeloma is what we call, you know, the blood cancers are what we call like the liquid tumors. But you can see that these differences and disparities apply across all disease states. Particularly with multiple myeloma, it's a cancer of the white blood cells that usually ends up affecting the body's immune system. And in the US, the African Americans make up 13 to 20% of the population, but we're 20% of patients who get multiple myeloma. But if you look at clinical trials designed with drugs designed to treat multiple myeloma, we're not a large population of those. So we're getting the disease and we're diagnosed at a later stage, unfortunately, and at a younger age than most, but we're not being represented in these clinical trials. And this chart here shows just that, like how many people in the US are actually getting multiple myeloma. And you can see where race actually plays a factor, and African Americans are those people who are getting the disease. And even with the access to therapy, right? So once we've been diagnosed, how many of us have access to not only good treatment, but the up and coming and cutting edge treatments? And you can see that first column is the difference in the non-Hispanic white persons, and all the other columns are minorities. So it's not just African Americans, it's across minority racial groups that access to therapy still remains a problem. So we can come up with all of these new cutting edge up and coming drugs, but if we're not getting it to the people who actually get the disease, then what are we actually doing?
Exactly. Ramona, if I can interject, I think that is what you're doing is excellent. We have heard this before, of course, and we clearly understand that. And it has not been, I just wanted to be very clear, it has not been for a lack of interest from the African-American community.
I completely agree. Because here's one of the things we do when we go to, you know, we design these drugs and we don't want to conduct clinical trials. And so we have to figure out where can we conduct these, like which sites can conduct these drugs. And when we talk to investigators that want to have this trial open, one of my first questions is, okay, what's your commitment to enrolling diverse patients? And they'll say, oh, we serve a diverse population. This is how many African Americans are in our area. This is how many come to our hospital. And we have to say, no, I get that. We've seen your stats, but how many will you commit to enrolling? And why, what is your barrier to enrollment? And a lot of times we hear back, oh, the community is just not trusting, you know, like they go back to Tuskegee and things like that. And I'm like, that's not what it is anymore. It was that at one point, but that's not what it is. We conduct these patient voice sessions where we have patients who have the disease give us feedback on what they want to see in a study. And we've had the African-American patients say, look, I want to be involved in clinical trials. My physician's not presenting these things to me, and I don't know why. And so I think there are a lot of implicit and inherent biases, and where we as investigators and physicians may think that a patient may not want to be approached without actually asking them if they want to be approached. So I agree, it's not a lack of interest. We definitely all agree on that. We know that this population is interested. It's how do they get access to it? And so if you have a physician that's not going to offer that to you because in their mind they think that maybe you are mistrustful and you won't want to participate in research because of historical things that have happened in our community, then you're not going to get that access because this is where you go for your health care.
Dr. Wefter.
Yes, thank you. A couple of points. The FDA recommends or suggests that industry seek to include minorities, but it does not require. And so until such time as the FDA requires that you have minorities to a certain percentage, you'll never reach that goal. It is my understanding, and I may be incorrect, but I think in Japan, you have to test the drug on Japanese before you can sell it to Japanese people. And so I think that it's a simple matter of government using its muscle to require the drug companies to seek and find minority at two places, minority investigators. So we don't have any minority clinical investigators. My office participated in a high blood pressure trial about 20 years ago called ALHAT. You might have heard of that clinical trial. It cost me money to pay my nurses to complete the papers in triplicate. And in those days, we weren't using computerized forms, and to mail them back in to Texas to get them processed. And so it was very time consuming, and a little bit of money we got per patient did not pay for my overhead. The average primary care physician cannot do that. And so we are underrepresented in investigators, number one. And there's no concerted effort to get Blacks involved in the clinical trials. And that's why we don't see Black people participating. It's not Tuskegee. So FDA has to require. And just one question while I have the floor about the right-sided colon cancer. Could one of you speak to Cologuard and its efficacy in Black people and whether or not they should, because my understanding is it is for average risk individuals. But a lot of Black people are being screened with Cologuard. If it comes back negative, they're not getting colonoscopies.
Yeah, thanks for the question, Dr. Webster, and may need to follow up with some more precise material on that. But you're right, it is supposed to be used in that average risk population. And I know they did set that up as a way. It's just one part of a screening paradigm, right? You know, you can't necessarily just take a negative test and say, okay, I'm good. You know, if you get a positive test, you should absolutely follow up with a colonoscopy. And even if I think their guidance in their documents is if you get a negative test, still speak with your doctor to understand, you know, what's the right decision personally for you.
Yeah, thank you, Justin.
Dr. Webster's comment as well about the FDA and saying that the government should flex their muscle a little bit more. I agree. But I also think that we shouldn't have to require the government to tell us to do something that we know is right. If you know it's something you should be doing, then just do it. I think finally, and unfortunately, it took incidents like the George Floyd incident this summer to get all of these companies to say, you know what, we're going to invest more in trying to understand and remove healthcare disparities. So I think now you see a lot of companies coming forward and putting initiatives into place to address just those things. And we have done some of that at J&J as well, where we're not only looking to get more African Americans into clinical trials, that's one thing, right? But we're looking to increase our minority investigators. We're trying to develop minority investigator training programs. Like, how can we train people who have an interest in doing clinical trials but don't necessarily have the experience to do just that? Going to sites that we historically have not gone to before, and not just for the diversity, but to say, hey, why are we going only to the same sites every time with these clinical trials? So we need to be more diverse in that area as well. So, I mean, you know, yeah, the government should flex its muscle a little bit and require these things, but maybe we should just take a look and say, what exactly is right? Let's do what's right and not have someone tell us it needs to be done.
To follow up on that statement is to really clarify the fact that we have a coalition of 27.7 million African-Americans. And I have been called never in the first stages of the clinical trial. Never, never. We always are called on the third stages of the clinical trial. That's number one. And then the pharmaceutical company, they fight you over the little coins that they want to spend on that. So they don't have a commitment. When they call you on the third stage of a clinical trial, they don't have a commitment. And then they want you to provide the perfect candidate when they do call. So, I mean, there's
a lot of work to be done. And that's why I'm thankful for your partnership in this space where we sit with Janssen that we can actually have a true authentic partnership, right? And really truly having these type of sessions where it's education, because we know that education is empowerment. Like Dr. Tolbert mentioned, there are so many barriers, even for myself going through my cancer journey, my physician never offered clinical trials as an option for treatment for me. It was only because I knew to go to clinicaltrial.gov to find a trial that fit my particular condition that I got that resource. So there are so many barriers, and I'm glad that Dr. Tolbert talked about what we're doing from a sponsor perspective. Like, we're really looking to diversify the pool. And when we say have more diverse investigators, we're not charging those diverse investigators to bring us diversity, right? Like, because that would be completely not fair. We want to make sure that all of our PIs who are engaged in our research make diversity, whatever it looks like, in whatever dimension of diversity or definition of diversity for that particular health condition. Because a lot of times it's African-American underrepresented. Sometimes it's women. Sometimes it's pediatrics, as Dr. Tolbert has, experience in that space. So we really, truly make that charge in the beginning. So at that protocol design, and when we're having those site visits, to really have everyone on board, because there's so many different barriers. It's not a one size fits all. Yes, we are late to the party. Yes, COVID in 2020 really unearthed some of the inequities that we have within our own healthcare infrastructures and research structures, but we're definitely, collaborating not only within Janssen Pharmaceuticals, but actually with our peers. So our Mercks, our AbbVies, we're all trying to come together collectively and say, we need to do better. Dr. Tolbert, I think we've experienced some of that in this multiple myeloma space where, we actually got pushback because we had lower African-American representation.
And as we should, right? As we should, because as I stated, these are the people who are getting the disease 2 and 3 times higher than any other group. But yet, when you look at the clinical trials and who's being represented in the clinical trials, it's not these persons. And so why is that? And one of those reasons were like just the perception from the people conducting trials that Black people don't want to participate in research trials because it's Tuskegee and they're scared and they don't trust the system. And that wasn't what it was. When you actually talk to a Black patient and ask them, right, they're like, no, I would do this clinical trial. Tell me more about it. Why didn't you tell me this before? And so that's where we are trying to overcome those. We've implemented trainings. We're on calls and training people as to this is how you should approach a patient. And it's unfortunate because when you speak to African-American patients, they're like, oh, if I had a Black doctor who was conducting this trial telling me this, that would make me feel more comfortable. And I get it, because sometimes I feel the same way. Like, just that trust that you get when someone who looks like you is doing the work. But there's not enough of us. We're like, 4% of all of the physicians here? There's not enough of us to go around. So one of the things we implemented, and I ran by just a couple of Black patients, is what if we had a video that has a person like me who's conducting the clinical trial, and it describes the aspects of the trial. You have information at the end to where you could ask questions to either your doctor, your investigator, or get them back to us. But it's something you could sort of get that trust a little bit, even just through the virtual space of here's this person. Okay, that's whose name is on this trial. That's who helped design this. This person will be looking out for my best interest. I feel that trust. So I may be more inclined to participate in the clinical trial. So just trying to think outside of the box of how to get outreach to these patients, because we know they're interested, but now we have to get the information to them and actually get them to enroll so they get the access to the medicine.
Yeah, Dr. Tolbert, Ramona, this is not the form to do this, but I have to put in just a little bit. I want to tell you, help is on the way. We have created a skeleton of exactly what you have described, but far more in depth and far more driven by the data from our church folks. And this is about a 10 year worth of work that we're going to put together, that we're putting together. And so we are so excited about this. It's just like busting through about this. And and we, and especially Justin and Dr. Tolbert, we have two of those videotapes for physicians who don't look like us, okay? For white physicians who either are not aware or just don't want the heavy burden of explaining to their Black patient exactly what's going on, they wouldn't have to do it because we are working with a phenomenal clinical investigator who have gotten over 25 years of experience in this to educate physicians, especially European physicians. So this is gonna be exciting piece of education stuff once we pull it all together. So I can't let the cat out of the box now, but I just wanted to have a little tease that help is on the way. And one of our critical consultant in the project will be Dr. Joseph Webster. So it's really exciting.
That's amazing. Yes.
Yes.
That's
what I'm glad you brought that up.
That's amazing to hear. That's really good news.
Yeah, because my next question I was going to ask Justin and Dr. Tolbert, what role can the church do or church have in this larger? So we're having a conversation now, but what can we truly do in this space to drive the impact, to really get to the community and kind of change this disparity that we're seeing?
I mean, there it is, right? Like the presenting the facts and getting the information out there to the community. I think that's a great way to do that. And not only giving the information to the church community, but then going out into who are those community physicians that may have an issue educating our patients, our, you know, my church community, they need to hear this. So I don't want you to be a barrier to them getting access or to them getting the information they need. So let me help you. And this is a way I can help you by making this video for you. I think that's awesome.
Well, let me say case in point is Minister Greg Allen. Please cut on your mic, Minister Greg Allen. Okay. His church is Israel Baptist Church in Baltimore. And they are just around the corner from Johns Hopkins University. So a premier research institution. And I'm sad to report that Johns Hopkins has not, because of the relationship that Johns Hopkins have with the African-American community in Baltimore, has not accessed that particular population. And part of the work that we are doing under the National Black Church Initiative is to sort of bridge that gap between a research institution like Johns Hopkins and the Black Church. And we are under discussions of that whole situation. So not only are we bringing the church, but we're bringing the university. Yeah. And also we're bringing, and I should tell you, we have the listing of every single African-American clinician in our congregation. So if you're a podiatrist, a physical therapist, you are a nurse's aide or RN, we have the list. We call them under our planned health emergency declaration, our health corps volunteers. And in Greg Allen's church, there is Dr. Dorothea Tucker, who we are working with now. And we just did a videotape with her, who are we working with now and who will spearhead that congregation into education and clinical trials. So we actually know the person's name. She is a physician, a retired African-American physician, given 30 years to this great work, who is passionate about clinical trial, who is educated, and we use her as a health care congregational educator, so who is qualified and ready to go. So we have been utilizing those tools for several years now. We're gonna be crystallizing them and optimizing them to a point that we will be able to tell you by zip code, what activity is going on. So we link the clinical trials with the zip codes and the where they have the clinical sites set around the country. So I'm telling you, stay tuned.
Collaboration, because, you know, again, must I not remind everyone that we did not get here overnight when it comes to health disparities and lack of representation around clinical trials. So it's definitely going to take collaborative efforts and different approaches to get some change in that space. But I thank you for bringing that up, Reverend Evans. That's great work that your organization is doing. I do want to invite all of those in the audience, if you have any questions, please put them in the chat so we can direct them to Dr. Tolbert or Justin. But again, you know, love this conversation that we're really having, because again, we can talk all we want, but what are we truly doing as actionable next steps to drive impact? So thank you, Reverend Evans, for sharing that information. And yeah. I know Minister Allen,
Can Reverend Allen speak to that? Because this is, he's sort of on the ground, real time type of stuff. So Allen, can you speak to what I just said about your church and your pastor and what y'all are doing and how you're bridging the gap between research institutions and the church? Go ahead.
Sure, well, thank you. My pastor is Reverend Dr. Harley Wilson II of the Israel Baptist Church of Baltimore City. And he's very community oriented and community minded in not only staying within inside the walls, but reaching people outside of the church. So working very actively, we have an outreach center. And as Dr. Evans has said, we have Dr. Dorothea Tucker, who is a member of the Israel Baptist Church. And also our health ministry of our church is very active as well in terms of trying to see how we can reach various segments of the community, because the dynamics of the community is changing very much. And even as Dr. Tolbert spoke about the Tuskegee and so forth, for our area, because of some of the reputation and history that Johns Hopkins has had with the community in terms of its failure, and I'll also say it this kind of way, using the community, people are reluctant to come forth. And then also there's some other things in terms of some of the issues that are taking place in the community in terms of drug use and so forth. But also I would like to ask this question, I guess, is the fact that when you talk about your clinical trials, how has it differed across the country? Because different regions will have different segments of people and how they are affected, or such as again with Johns Hopkins, not to badmouth them, but many people are reluctant because of past history still and are not being tapped into for, and we are trying to make services available to everyone, if that makes sense.
No, that's a great question. And thank you for bringing that up, because I would be remiss to say that some of the issues that we're having here in our communities in Chicago will be the same that Dr. Tolbert is experiencing in her communities in Philadelphia, right? So it really has been a regional localized effort to really identify what are the barriers and how can we do better. And a lot of that truly boils down to what sites we're utilizing for participation in our clinical trials. So like Dr. Tolbert mentioned earlier, utilizing federally qualified health centers, because we know that they are the epicenter of health for a lot of marginalized communities, tapping them to be part of our clinical trial studies. And like Reverend Evans said, not just waiting for that phase three, how do we engage them into phase two smaller studies as we move, you know, through our drug development process, but also, you know, partnering with people in the community like yourself, Minister Allen, because unfortunately, you know, that relationship that you mentioned between the city of Baltimore and its residents and Johns Hopkins, that's unfortunate. But as Dr. Tolbert mentioned earlier, there's roles and tools and resources we can provide as sponsors, as pharma companies, to kind of bridge that gap. Again, not a relationship that happened overnight, but we can definitely add tools and resources to drive conversations and to drive those next steps as what do those partnerships look like with our sites that we select for our studies, which Johns Hopkins, you know, tends to be part of our clinical trial studies. How do we bridge that gap with the community?
And Ramona, I would say too, like you said, forming the partnership with the churches and their communities, but not just going to them when we need patients, right? Like starting, yes, like actually having a relationship, right? So it can't just be a one-way thing where, hey, can we talk to you about getting us some patients? Like starting those relationships early. What else can we do? How else can we help in the community? Because all of that helps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, another value for this conversation, because we're identifying what are those barriers, right? Because again, we can't think of it as a monolithic issue, but it really can be, you know, as different as geographical areas that, you know, we have different barriers that are presented and different opportunities to collaborate, to have these conversations, right? Because these conversations need to continue to happen. We need to acknowledge some of the historical ills that we know are true in our foundations of medicine and also in clinical trials, And, you know, that's part of the trust building. That's part of, like you said, Dr. Tolbert, being present, engaging in conversations without coming with an ask. Like, I'm not saying come join this cardiovascular study, you know, but let's talk. Let's talk about how can we partner, truly partner to drive impact.
Yeah, I think that Dr. Webster has some very unique perspective here. And Dr. Webster, I'd like to ask you to comment on, we know about the barriers. Comment on any success stories that you have had with clinical trials in terms of working with either pharma or university setting clinical trial. I know that there has been some breakthrough. And this is one of the part of our thing is that we will point out those success stories as well. Dr. Webster?
Well, I wish I had a long list of success stories, but unfortunately I do not. But prior to going further into that answer, the issue in Baltimore, issue in Chicago is the same for Miami and Seattle. I've worked at the National Medical Association on the board for about 20 years. Project Impact, trying to get more Blacks involved in clinical trials. It's a national ongoing problem, so it doesn't matter what city. It just up south, down south, out south, America's America. We have the same issues. They just have a different coating, different cloak. So the barriers are always there. The success story, the ALLHAT study was a success story. It just cost me some money. If one look at the ALLHAT data, we had about 96 patients in that trial. It lasted about 4 or 5 years. And the way that we treat high blood pressure in African Americans was reshaped by the results of the ALLHAT study. It was well done. The real downside of the study was that it was a federally funded study, and there were very little, I hate to say it that way, but very little money involved. The federal government cuts it to the bone when they conduct research studies. So there's very little profit for the doctors. And again, I lost money in that clinical trial. So pharma does pay a little bit more for some of the patients per patient than the federal government normally does. But so the success story was learning about doing the protocol. It was more the methodology, training my staff, more so than dollars gained from the study. So it was an opportunity to participate in a national trial that made an impact on the lives of people.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you brought up the National Medical Association, because that's one of our partners, Janssen Pharmaceuticals. We were part of Project Impact, where there was concerted effort made to engage providers of color in investigative roles for our clinical trials, but also happy to be a part of the reboot. So we're doing a Project 2.0, because there are different issues now than there were before, right? Again, 2020 has not created any new inequities, but it's definitely shone the light on some of the things that have always been present. So really a call to action for us to show up differently in the sponsor pharma space. So thank you for mentioning NMA. But, you know, again, I understand, you know, we have broader issues as to barriers to healthcare, but there are those nuances, you know, if we're talking about folks who live in Alabama versus people who live in more metropolitan areas like New York, there are different nuances that, you know, again, it can't be a blanket one size fits all approach. And that's why I'm happy again to partner with you, Dr. Webster and Reverend Evans, because we can really drill in on a membership of National Black Church Initiative to say, okay, let's engage folks in conversations. Let's do these educational webinars around clinical trials, but then let's truly learn what does the community need? Because again, it's not a monolithic approach.
Mm-hmm. I don't hope to be a broken record here, but I want people to leave this talk encouraged to know that we recognize all of the historic barriers. So that's clear. But let me tell you what's also clear about the Black community. What's also very clear about the Black community is that even though that we have these barriers in place, we find some ways to create success. And what we are doing at the National Black Church Initiative is going to be a game changer, because we understand all of the barriers. We know how exactly to get around those barriers. I won't give you, for instance, for Johns Hopkins. Minister Allen said that they have a rocky relationship with the African-American community. Well, one of the ways that we hope to get around that barriers is not to cut Johns Hopkins out, but to provide education to critical personnel that deals with clinical trials. Let me just give you this for a simple. I don't believe in the history of John Hopkins that they have ever had an African-American minister trainer in terms of educating them on cultural diversity and sensitivity and dealing with the population. That has never happened before. And this is one of the things that we will be bringing. We'll be educating the institutions, we'll be educating the clinicians, we'll be bringing African-American and Latino clinicians to educate them. Then we will be bringing in our congregations, because we got a lot of them, to evaluate whether or not when they hear the feedback from the clinician, whether or not they got it. And it's one thing that we do all of this evaluation, but it's always an evaluation toward the patient, but it's never the evaluation toward the presenter. So that type of data, I want to tell you, we will drill down and get that data so that when we go into communities, we clearly understand what we're up against and how to do a workaround to get the results that we need. So this is really exciting in terms of gathering just basic data in terms of presentation, application, and then also education, outreach, and recruitment. So I say stay tuned. This is going to be a great ride.
Thank you, Reverend Evans. Yeah. So I want to thank everyone for participating on the call. We look forward to the next clinical trials lecture series to be announced soon. But again, inviting any of those in the audience that have any questions to put them in the chat. Dr. Webster, did you want to make any closing remarks?
Since you're true to my arm, I think I will. Yes. First of all, I enjoyed it very much. Again, Reverend Evans, for your vision. The partnering that we're looking forward to continuing with you, Janssen, and Corporate America and NBCI, that partnership need to also drill down to our local core community levels. I call it intersectionally cross disciplines, because at politics is local. And so a lot of things that need to take place, city governments and city councils and city commissions, there are times we might need that professional voice coming in from Big Pharma as we're trying to make a point at a meeting, to try a group of church meetings. And so sometimes to partner all the way down to the local level make a big difference. I look forward to doing that.
Yeah, and it should not be overlooked that Janssen and J&J is an industry leader in this area. And we will make our membership know that you have really made this investment, and we're looking forward to creating just a great dynamic here among African-American patients, Latino patient, African-American physicians, Latino physician, African-American clinicians, Latino clinicians, and our new partner, Janssen and Johnson and Johnson. So we are absolutely excited about going forward and making this happen, and not talking about it, but actually being able to really make a difference locally and see it by the data. And I want to say by the data, so we understand the importance of collecting that data and making that available.
Thank you, Reverend Evans. Yeah. I want to take this opportunity to thank both panelists and offer the floor to you for any closing remarks or comments.
Yeah, sure. I have some, but Jaszianne, you want to go ahead?
Sure. Thank you for inviting me. This was a great discussion. It was great to hear about what the NBCI is doing just for the community and education-wise. I cannot wait to see what's coming forward. I'm excited about it. It's great to hear. And you know, just that we all keep doing the work. It's a lot of work to be done. And as Ramona stated, it's not going to change overnight, but happy to see that so many of us on this call are invested in this important work.
Yeah, and from my perspective, again, thanks everybody for having me here. I feel like I was probably educated more than I educated anybody else. And so if I could tie back two points together, maybe, you know, Ramon mentioned there's a lot of work still to do. And Reverend Evans, you pointed out how, you know, you'd never been called before that phase three sort of stage, right? And I guess that's what makes me excited and hopeful from this is that in CRC, we're early. We're in that preclinical phase, like, right. And we're listening and what do we, you know, where are the gaps? What what are we missing? You know, we want to learn from this and go ahead and make those proper steps now and make sure we collect that data, but fill those other gaps as well. Site selection, everything. So it's just, you know, it's the right time for us. So I'm excited about this partnership, you know, coming together early like this to see how we can work together.
Thank you.
Thank you. Reverend Evans, the man in charge.
I'm absolutely excited to certainly work with Janssen and Johnson on this effort, and enormously excited to demonstrate that we have the wherewithal to do so. And the most important point to be made here is that we are not starting from scratch. And we're not starting from scratch. We also are eager to participate in clinical trials that is very clearly defined, that there's literature, that's education, there's outreach, there's sympathy, there's cultural competency, and certainly an ethical clinical trial. And we are also excited about gathering the data, which is so very important in terms of the fact that whether or not this therapy, this procedure, this new medicine is actually going to work on African-American physiology. So, hey, we are going to make this happen across the country. And we also are going to bring our Latino brothers and sisters along. So if they don't want us, it really doesn't matter because we're going to be present.
All right. Thank you. And with that, thank you. This has been a great webinar. And again, you will soon hear about our next one rolling out in that topic. But thank you everyone for joining us this Friday afternoon. And what a great way to conclude the month of March, Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month, with conversations around this topic. So with that, bid adieu until next time.